Lately, many radar sensors became available for relatively cheap prices. In this video, I will give you an overview of what is available and how they compare. And of course, we will have a look into how they work and test a few of them. After viewing this video, you should be able to choose the right sensor for your needs. And you should know which are overpriced. Gritzy YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. Over the years, we got a few iterations of radar sensors. Some of them were very cheap, but most of them were quite expensive. This changed with the arrival of new radar chips for 24 GHz and 60 GHz. So today we will look what radar sensors can measure and how they do it. What kind of sensors we get, how they compare, do some testing, and check the integration into Home Assistant or other applications. And finally, you get my verdict. Radar is the abbreviation of radio detection and ranging. It was very important for the outcome of World War II, where it got a huge push when cavity magnetrons were invented by the British, who shared them with the Americans. These high-performance tubes enabled the building of strong transmitters for very high frequencies. The high frequencies were needed because the resolution of a radar heavily depends on its frequency. And the high power was needed because they wanted to detect far away and small airplanes. Radars emit signals and listen to the part reflected by conductive material such as metal or water. Because they use directional antennas, they can detect from which direction a signal is reflected and how strong. Early radars just showed the presence of an object. Later, they used the Doppler effect to determine its speed. Fast-moving objects reflect the signal on a higher or lower frequency, similar to a passing police car. The bigger the frequency difference, the faster the object. Unfortunately, it was not possible to measure distance exactly until another invention was made. FMCW radars. They change their frequency at a rapid pace. This frequency change has the effect that it not only shows the speed of the plane, but also its distance. Unfortunately, both signals are mixed, so the distance of fast-flying planes is not accurate. Still, the results were usable. Our new radar modules are based on the same principles. They transmit on a high frequency, receive the reflected signal, and make some calculations. Some radars can only show the speed, others the distance, and the more sophisticated, both. Let's have a look at the different generations of such sensors. The first sensors covered on this channel were these two. One runs at about 10 GHz, the other at 24 GHz. Both were Doppler radars and provided an audio frequency proportional to the speed of the detected object. While the first was hardly working, the second was able to detect the speed. We tried it for the detection of bicycles, but we were not able to get more than 5 to 7 meters range. Fortunately, one of my viewers, Matthew, from Limpkin, kept trying, and here we have a small device consisting of a radar module, a sensitive amplifier, and an STM32 MCU. He did a marvelous documentation if you are interested in how he built it. In today's video, it is one of the few sensors outputting speed. You get sensors with longer ranges, but unfortunately, they are still much more expensive. 24 GHz is a so-called ISM band. That can be used by everybody without a license as long as the device complies with the regulations. 10 GHz is no ISM band, by the way. On this module, we see the typical antenna arrangement, a set of transmitting and a set of receiving antennas. A rule of thumb, the bigger the antennas, the more directional they are. So, the range becomes longer and the detection angles get smaller. These modules were quite big and extremely simple. As Shahryar from the signal path showed, the frequency of those sensors is very unstable, and for sure they cannot be certified by authorities. So we need something better and smaller. When smartphones started to include all kinds of sensors, they were produced in high quantities for cheap. This is why we got all our cheap but good sensors like accelerometers. A similar thing happened with radar. Not with smartphones, but with cars. Newer cars need sensors to measure distance. First came parking sensors, then the distance sensor with ranges up to a few hundred meters. They operate at 77 GHz. So companies started to develop cheap chips for such frequencies. The quality of such sensors has to be extremely high compared with our simple CDM324. They need stable frequencies and sensitive receivers. A similar technology can be used to produce chips for 24 and 60 GHz radar chips. So also those became cheaper. Here is a selection of more than 20 boards. The price range starts below $5 and surpasses $100. So what do we get for our money? Let's start with the cheapest. They are all below $10 and all come from the same company, Hylink. Operate in the 24 GHz ISM band and contain chips from the same company. Their output power is quite low, around 12 dBm or 16 milliwatt. This is not unexpected as the cost of power increases with frequency. The biggest difference is the antennas. Some have simple antennas with a 60 degree opening. Others have up to 4 antennas with a reduced opening of 25 degrees in the vertical and 45 degrees in the horizontal direction. We should assume that everything else equal, their range should be much longer. But according to the datasheet, it is not so. So we have to test them. The LD2050 has another antenna configuration. Its range should be in between. The model numbers containing 11XX and below seem to be obsolete. The only other sub-$10 board comes from MIC Radar. Its output power is only 6 dBm, even if it has the same chip as the LD2411. Its antenna is half the size of the larger Hylink sensors, and its datasheet range is 4 to 8 meters. The LD2410B and the LD2411S have Bluetooth. The LD2450 too, but it can only be used to update its firmware. So let's quickly test these sensors. It is beautiful outside and Dishka monitors the tests. The LD2410B gets to a range of around 4 meters, not the 6 meters of the datasheet. You get an app for iOS and Android, and you can easily integrate both of them into Home Assistant, either via Bluetooth or connected to an ESP8266 running ESP Home. The LD2450 only can be connected to an ESP Home device. The LD2411 and the LD2450 can detect moving targets up to about 6 meters. All of them can also indicate the direction of the target. This might be a useful feature if you want to block a particular area. The next two sensors are $20, respectively $32. The IFL2411A is similar to the CDM324 as it outputs an analog Doppler voltage or frequency. It seems to lack a stable frequency because I did not find a crystal. For me, a special module without a lot of documentation. This 24 GHz module from Seeds has similar specs to the LD2450, just a much higher price. It seems it has been replaced by one of the newer 60 GHz sensors. The last in the 24 GHz crowd is the MR24BSD1. Compared with all other boards, it has a huge antenna. Its main purpose is sleeping detection. Its range is below 3 meters, which is okay for this purpose. I will not include it in the current test because of its special purpose. Maybe I will once make a video about sleep analyzing radars. That would also contain the next contender, the MR60BHA1. It operates in the next higher ISM band, 60 GHz. Its price is $45 plus shipping. Its detection range is only 1.5 meters, which is okay for its purpose. What do you miss if you look at this sensor? Yes, you're right. There are no more antennas. Strange. Only a sharp look at the chip reveals the secret. The antennas are inside the chip. The 60 GHz wavelength is only 5 mm. Incredible. But of course, the detection resolution of such short wavelength signals is extremely good. And this is the domain of our most expensive module. The XM125 from the Swedish company Actioneer. It works on 60 GHz and has on-the-chip antennas too. But its main purpose is the detection of very small and fast movements over a reasonable distance. So, its purpose is comparable with the other contenders. According to its datasheet, the range is 20 meters. Its update speed is so fast that it has to be connected via the SPI bus, and its accuracy is millimeters. The evaluation kit costs around $130. But astonishingly, the sensor alone is only $25. That is a very good price, if the datasheet is right. I tried hard to get this sensor to show me its capabilities. Unfortunately, all the examples of their tool shows a ton of things, but not what I expected. The only working example was presence detection at a distance of about 5 meters. Nothing to write home about. I tried walking, I tried it with my metal bike, and I tried to measure speed. Nothing worked. I felt like a real noob. Unfortunately, this is not the first time I have encountered such code. Particularly, technically savvy people want to show how good they are and forget that all the others are not as good. So guys, create a noobs mode that just shows presence for the promised 20 meters range and speed in the same range. Then you can continue with the rest. Just to show you how easy it can be, here is the test of Mathieu's sensor. It does what is expected. 60 GHz is a fascinating technology. I'm working on another video that uses this ISM band. Today I can just reveal a detail about why the 60 GHz band became a free-to-use ISM band. The attenuation curve of oxygen has its maximum right at 60 GHz. So signals are attenuated a lot, which is not good for wireless communication because you lose much of your precious power. In the next video, we will see if we still get something usable from this ISM band. Stay tuned! My verdict? For presence detection, I would go with a cheap LD2410. And if you need more range, with the LD2411 or LD2450. Also, they can easily be integrated into Home Assistant. As said, the breathing detector boards are for a different purpose and deserve special treatment. The XM125 has a lot of potential, and for its price, it could have been a winner if the creator of this video would have been up to his task. But keep in mind, these are active sensors and therefore consume around 100 mA, so they have to be powered by mains, not batteries. This was all for today. As always, you find the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.